I'm going to talk to you about a type of risk which is much greater than the financial risk that you see going in the market, and it's much more personal, which is your personal risk. You're all sitting in this room because you've invested heavily in your education. You've invested years in yourself, and the real risk is that you don't take the years and the money you've invested in yourself and capitalize on that. And there's an even bigger risk. It's easy to gamble other people's money. The sorts of financial risk that you see happening at the moment are the same financial risk that led to the credit crisis. And what's the problem? It's OPP. It's other people's property. It's other people's money. It's easy to sit in a hedge fund and gamble other people's money. It's easy to lend out a balance sheet when it's someone else's money at risk. But it's much harder to risk something which is bigger, and that's to bet on yourself. The greatest risk that all of us can choose to take in our lives is to bet on ourselves and to go for what we truly want. And how many people are following their dreams? How many people truly bet on themselves in their lives? Because it's seen as risky, right? It's risky to go for what you truly want and maybe fail. But I suggest with all of these topics of risk, it's actually often a question of a definition of risk. What is more risky? Is it more risky to go for what you truly want in your career, in your life, and risk not getting it? Or is it more risky to look back 40 years from now and look at the life that you could have lived relative to the life that you chose? What is more risky? How many of you know what you really want in your careers? Not many. How many of you are going to follow that? Not many. It's hard to know, isn't it? When I started this work, as much as today, my work today is about getting what you want. But when this work began for me, my question was, what do I want? For almost 10 years, I read thousands of books, and I spent my weekends and nights researching that question. What do I want? At the same time, figuring out how do you get it? Because the harder question is actually identifying what it is you want so you can keep moving towards it. But what I found in the end was the answer. And the answer is ultimately that, see that end point, that what do you want? The answer is that you probably will never really know. We make these questions so big. At some point in our lives, we step back and we say, well, what do I really want? We say, I don't know what I really want. All right, so what do I really want? I don't know what I really want. Well, you really got to figure that out, because if you're going to get what you want, you have to figure out what you want. So what do I really want? I don't know. Right, but you have to figure that out. And so you find yourself stuck in this cycle. And the answer that I determined after years and years of research that actually worked for me and now I teach to other people is actually you make the question much smaller. So even if you don't know what that endpoint is, you can come up with some vision of that endpoint. When this work began for me, I had a very lofty goal. I want to do what I want every day. I want to do what I love to do every single day of my life. I really liked Wall Street. I had a great job at Goldman. I really liked working for Goldman. I had a great job at Carlyle. I really liked working for Carlyle. These are not the sorts of jobs that people leave. But I didn't love it. And I wanted to absolutely love every day of my life. And what's the answer? Identify that life, that career that you imagine you really love. Make it lofty, make it general, and then just keep taking the steps every day. So even if the job that you're starting in a couple of weeks isn't that lofty, isn't that goal 40 years from now, you know that that step right in front of you is the step that will lead you to your next step, is a step that will lead you to the step after that. And so a lot of my work comes down to processes. So rather than seek out one answer, instead build a process that allows you to keep moving towards what you want. And more importantly, love that process every day. Too many of us are spending our lives on what's called the hedonic treadmill. That means the belief that when we get this, then we'll feel a certain way. The belief that if we can only make it to that next level in our career, if we can only get that next car, if we can only get those next pair of Louboutins, ladies, then suddenly our life will be everything that we imagined it could be. But it's false. All of these ideas end up being false. Just like risk management, we're built a certain way. We're built with a lot of cognitive biases. So the key is, how do you every day step inside how you want to feel? If you want to love your life when you get to that end point, you've got to love it today. These are what I came up with in all my work. I call them the two secrets of getting what you want. There's only two secrets to all this stuff. I read thousands and thousands of books, and it left me only more and more confused, because none of them gave me the answers I was looking for. They gave me a lot of different stories. They gave me a lot of frameworks, a lot of ways of thinking, and there was a lot of good content out there. But I needed it to be much, much more simple. And so in this book that I've just written, and in all of my work, I boil it down to these two secrets of getting what you want. How do you get what you want? No matter what it is, if it's your career, if it's your life, if it's money, you have to know what it is you want. You have to have definite purpose. Definite purpose doesn't mean you have to know where you want to be 40 years from now. It means you have to have definite purpose on the next step that keeps you moving there. If you want to be more senior on Wall Street, the first step is to do a very, very good job of being more junior, and then let the steps keep unfolding. So you've got to have definite purpose on that. If you want to get a job out of school, you've got to get good grades. Well, you sure as hell got to pass, right? You sure as hell got to pass. A system to get it, that means no matter what you want, rather than haphazardly assemble ideas on how you get it, instead you develop a rigorous system to get it. Like a production line for a car. A production line for a car has every step laid out in sequence. They're not making it up as they go along. Some guy doesn't roll up with a welder at some point. Someone doesn't bolt on a wheel here one day and the next day over here. Every step of it is laid out. And when you think about everything that you've ever learned to do in your life, you can break it down into a system that leads to success. If you want to get in shape at the gym, again, the same thing. Repetition, certain set of exercises, and you just keep at it. The two secrets of getting what you want. There's a challenge in this, though. This is the hard part. This is the challenge. When I was in university after my first year, I was sitting around a cafeteria table with a lot of my mates, and they were all joking about how they had passed and how it was they'd just done the right amount of work. So they'd done enough work to pass, but not too much work that they got great grades. And then one of my buddies turned to me and he said, "What's up?" And I said, I don't think about the world the same way. And he said, "What do you mean?" And I said, "Well, to me, you have this great opportunity. You're here and you have this great opportunity to have your education take you wherever you want to get to. So why would you be content with passing? Why would that be the standard that you set yourself? Why not go for what you really want?" And it's in my work, it's the difference between being a weekend runner and being a competitive athlete. A weekend runner will throw on a pair of shorts and a pair of sneaks and go out for a Sunday run. And they'll have fun, they'll go for a great run, they'll get in decent shape doing it. But a professional athlete has to approach their career very, very differently. They're not going to win that way. They have to be very regimented in the way they train. They have to be very thoughtful about the distances they run, about their nutrition. Every step of the way, they're incredibly thoughtful about what it takes to win. And the challenge that many of us face is even very highly successful people get a great job and then they put their head down and they grind it out. Because it's easy to put your head down and grind it out. But most people who put their heads down and grind it out don't get what they want. They wake up 10 years later and they wonder where the last 10 years went. Or they reach a certain level where they get stuck because the world gets increasingly competitive. The challenge is, it's harder to step back and do this. The benefit is that it's much easier once you actually do it. Once you regiment, once you design your system to win, not only do you get better results, you have more fun along the way. It's easier. You don't have to be on that production line wondering, do I weld the tire over here, and you know, do I bolt on some part over there? It's just all laid out for you. Then it's just a matter of doing it and getting in the flow, getting in the groove of doing it. The key topic in risk management, to float back to your topic of risk management, is ultimately there's only... The power of risk management actually is simplicity, which is, when you think about it, risk management is about controlling what you can control. If you look at this up here, what could this fellow control? At this point, not a lot, right? Not a lot. Leading up to that point, well, the conditions are clearly pretty rough. Did he put the right tires on the car? Did he push it too fast into the corner? Did he brake too hard? Did he brake too soft? Did he steer in too late?
Did he stay at home?
Did he stay at home, right? Did he not train? Did he not get his stuff together to do that? But when you think about all the things that you can control, really the first place to start is you start with, well, what's outside of your control? What's outside of your control? There's a great TEDx talk by a model named Cameron Russell. And in this, and it, as soon as she did it, it got millions of views, because in that TEDx talk, she says, I won the genetic lottery. She's a well-known, famous model, making a lot of money as a model. And as she says, because she won the genetic lottery, she's lucky that she was born a certain way at a certain point in time when her genetic makeup is considered beautiful. She has no control over that. All of us have benefited the same way. We won the genetic lottery. Lillian is from a country with 1 billion people, most of which... 80% of the world's population lives on less than $10 a day. We all won the genetic lottery. In your careers, in your jobs, there are massive variables you have no control over. You have no control over the state of the economy when you graduate. You have no control over how many jobs will be offered by a certain employer. You have no control over who the other qualified candidates are. There's only one thing that you can control. In marketing, there's a notion called the four P's of marketing: price, position, place, and promotion. The four P's of marketing. They're powerful ideas for marketing anything. Steve Jobs, who was an incredible marketer and designer of wonderful products. There's a great book on Steve Jobs by a guy named Carmine Gallo. It's on the presentation secrets of Steve Jobs. And it details his process for when he would do one of those big product launches. And his process was incredibly rigorous. For a month before the presentation, he was putting together the decks. Weeks before, he was scripting it out over and over again, scripting it out. In the week before the presentation, he was drilling it with himself in the mirror, with his product managers, just refining it, getting it better and better through continuous improvement. So what are the four P's of success in my work? The four P's are very simple: preparation, 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 preparation. The only thing you can control is preparation. The only thing you can control is what you are willing to do in lead up to whatever it is that you need to do, whether you're that competitive runner, whether you're a risk manager. And the specific topic we're going to get to is when you go and sit in that job interview. The only variable you can control is the preparation you do ahead of that meeting. This is my system for getting what you want. The two secrets of getting what you want generalize into this five-step framework that I creatively call the system of getting what you want. Five steps: define what you want, so know what you want. Again, it doesn't need to be the long-term 20-year vision. It can be, in my first year, in my internship on Wall Street, I want to get a job offer. You set a very definite goal. The second step, getting it, says figure out what it takes to succeed. This is where most people fail. Most people fail because the old paradigms of success are about brute force. Getting it means figure out what does it really take to win. Most advice you hear: put your head down and work hard. Truth is, as an intern or an analyst or an associate on Wall Street at a very junior level, it is actually a lot of the formula. Work harder than the next guy. Spend more hours, show more dedication. It's an important part of the formula. But getting it says understand what's truly valued and know how to do it. So getting it says do a study. If you have to get good at sitting exams, what is getting it? What is getting it for exams? Memorization, write fast. This is the only reason I got great grades in university. Good memory, I wrote fast. And massive amounts of preparation. Getting it is actually very simple. In a lot of courses, it's class participation, there's all these other things. But getting it means know what it takes to win. Know how you win at something. Not head down, work hard. Most people head down, work hard, will fail. Why? Because it's not enough of an edge. The greatest athlete in the world isn't the one who trains the hardest. They train hard, they work hard, but they just get better than everyone else. Plan it. Have a plan. Know what it takes. So know what it takes to win and then plan your ability to do it. Execute it, which means get very good at actual execution. Most of us are. If you're in this room, most of us are pretty damn good at execution. In the real world, a lot of people aren't. They get stuck with procrastination, but execution's an important part of it. And the final part is the part that's often missing. You see this model down here. This is the generalization of this bigger model, which is there are two parts to getting what you want. The first part is have a process to get it. That's the first four steps. Design a process that's bulletproof. Second part is you have to build the skills. It's like the best basketball team in the world might have the greatest strategies. They might run a great defense. They might really know every single strategy for winning the game. But if none of the players can dribble, they're screwed. Right? If they don't have the skills to actually play basketball, they're screwed. This again is where a lot of people in the real world fail. Most people's education stops when they leave university, when they leave college, when they leave business school. There are very, very few people out there who are continuously learning. They say leaders are readers for a reason. The people who lead are the people who continue learning. And in my world, getting skills is actually very, very specific, and you'll see this in a moment, which is know the skills that it takes to win and get very, very good at them. And they're not hard skills to learn, but again, it takes that level of effort. So let's apply this to something very specific, which is getting the job. I have a series of videos on my website that you can look at for free. It's 40 minutes, 10 minutes on each one of these steps. And the whole point of that process is design this process to get the job. Take all the things we talked about, the two secrets of getting what you want. Know what you want and have a system to get it. And then that subsystem we just looked at, it's a combination of process and skills. What do you see up here? You see three process steps and skills. So as you're looking ahead and you're thinking about interviewing for jobs, you can do what everybody else does. Do your resume, drop it off somewhere, put on your suit, put on a little bit of makeup, go sit in the interview, right? And you know, someone's going to win that, probably the person with the best GPA. You know, because the getting it involves a lot of all these factors that happen before you step into the room. Or you can approach it like that professional athlete. After I left Wall Street, I took 18 months off where I did nothing of any real value. I hung out a lot. I read a lot. I worked on my process of figuring out what I wanted. And then I decided to go back to Wall Street. I'd been out of work for 18 months and I wanted to move to the buy side. So if you know Wall Street, you recognize there's a sell side and there's a buy side. It's often very hard to move from banking to the buy side, particularly at the level I was at, which was vice president. So I knew that it would be hard to get the jobs, but I only applied to two jobs and I got both of them. Is that because I was smarter than the other candidates? No. They're incredibly smart people who we are all competing against. We know that. Was I better qualified? No, I was the least qualified. The other candidates had buy-side jobs already. The only reason that I got both of those jobs and they failed was because I spent thousands of hours preparing for those interviews. Everything that I teach people to do today are things that I built for myself. I didn't read a bunch of books and try to figure this out and then go try and teach people. I built it because I needed it. And I built this process to get those jobs. And you'll see the first step is there are two processes that I'll walk through with you. The second is preparation. You got to do your homework. Homework is the obvious part, right? If you are walking into an interview at Goldman Sachs, you should know that the firm was founded in 1869. You got to know all that junk that people expect you to know. You got to give them the right rhetoric. What distinguishes the culture? There are a lot of great tools out there, you know, Wall Street Oasis, Wall Street Prep. They do a good job of preparing you at a very basic level for these interviews. The Black Book, I'll get to in a moment. The resume, there's no such thing as a resume. There's your resume for that specific job. This is all about, in my view, you should spend hundreds of hours on your resume. Every word matters. It's the only thing that they've got to figure out whether they want to see you or not. All of your years of college boil down to whether someone likes the font on this piece of paper and says, yes, they want to see you. Execution. Before you walk into a meeting, what's your pre-game ritual? Every athlete, before they go out and prepare, they prepare themselves for every game. So what's that process? In the meeting, what are the tools you're using? After the meeting, how do you assess your performance? Again, remember, this is an approach. This is not for the faint of heart. This is an approach like analogous to a professional athlete. You're taking the job of getting the job incredibly seriously. And then skills. What skills matter most to getting the job? Mindset. So most people don't train mindset. We're not taught to train it, but mindset is thinking. You know all this stuff about power of positive thinking and all that stuff? Yeah, it's part of it. But really what it's about is training your mind like an athlete does. For every race that Michael Phelps swam, since the age of 7, Michael Phelps every night has gone to bed and imagined in his mind a videotape of his perfect swim. Since age 7, every night. That's mindset. It's stepping into the room like you know you've already gotten the job. It's seeing yourself as having the job. Because if you don't believe that you can get the job, they sure as hell are not going to give it to you. You have to believe it to convince them. The second one is communication skills. It's communicating. When you walk into the room, it's communicating. So how do you get good at that? How do you get exceptional at that? You can read books like How to Win Friends and Influence People. If you read that one book, and practice it for a year, you'll be ahead of 99% of people on this topic. Because no one trains it. Communications is one of these skills where people assume that you're either naturally good at it or not. They look at someone, they say, wow, that person's a great communicator. There are a lot of people who are built that way. But most people who are exceptional at things are not built that way. They train themselves to be exceptional. Selling. Everything in the world is selling. You're always selling. When you're talking about going to this restaurant or that restaurant, you're selling. An interview is selling you. It's selling your only commodity. It's selling you. Get good at selling. There's a great book. Read this book, The Art of Selling by Tom Hopkins. If you read that one book, if you read those two books and you practice them and you train them, you'll walk into job interviews more prepared than, other than this group, 99% of people. Because they haven't trained these things. But they're all skills that can be trained. It's like in The Wolf of Wall Street. Have you guys seen that movie? Yeah. Huh? I mean, that's a good example of how not to use selling. But if you think about the scripts that he's using to sell that junk, it's all designed around tools of communications and selling. Because when you're able to use these tools to your advantage, you're able to do things that other people can't do. So let's jump into two of these processes. This is the first process, which I call the job process, which is actually quite simple, right? Imagine there are three parts to anything that you need to do in this world. This formula works for selling. I train people in selling with this. bankers who are in the coverage world, sourcing. What are the jobs you're going for? Create a big list and then start to figure out how you get in there. There's very simple ways, of course, right? Drop off a resume. But if you really want it, how would a professional athlete go about it? How do you source the opportunities you want and then keep track of them and get serious about it? The second is the interview process, which is, well, I'll get to next, which, how do you design your process when you walk in the room? Again, you can just go sit in there, or you can become a killer at doing that. The third is, how do you close? Every salesman needs to understand closing. There are a lot of people who come in and look at a car and they like a car, but the expert salesman knows how to actually get them to buy it. But the greatest leverage in the world is, you know, you've probably been into interviews, or you've heard of people in interviews where some point through the interview, like half an hour in, the interviewer is actually selling the interviewee. Why? Because they realize they want that person and the dynamic has changed. How do you become that person who's bought, not sold? You want to be bought. And you do that through leverage. You do that through tactics. You do that through training yourself to be the person that they want to hire. Why? That's getting it. Why do they want you? This is the job interview process. This is a framework that I use to teach meetings or other processes, which is ultimately what I call the black book. Is, imagine, before you walk into your interviews, imagine you have a 20-page book called your black book. What is in that black book? Someone says, tell me about you. Hey, tell me about yourself. What do you say? Just make it up on the spot? Most people do. But imagine in your black book, you'd written out questions like that with your best answers. And then you'd stood in front of the mirror and rehearsed them. Hey, tell me about you. Because you know sure as hell you can write 15 questions that you're going to get. And your black book details those questions. Why? Because you can. Right? Because you can. You can prepare yourself to do all these things. Every process of interaction begins with rapport. You walk into the room, you shake someone's hand, within 30 seconds they like you or dislike you. Most people are blown out at that point. When you understand rapport from reading one of these books on communications, you understand what gets people to like you. If you're wearing glasses, I might pull a pair of glasses out, put them on. You know why? You know what rapport is? You know what people like? Themselves. People like people who remind them of them. That's rapport. You start using their language. You start doing stuff that's called matching and mirroring. If you're sitting a certain way, I sit the same way. Unconsciously, that person sees me as like them. Oh, I really like that guy. What do you like about him? Oh, he just reminded me of me. You hear this stuff all the time. That's rapport. And it can be manipulated. Profiling, same thing. When you're sitting in an interview, the person opposite you, your job is to convince them to want you. Profiling means the best way to convince someone to want you is to understand who they are. Again, to use the car example, person comes in to buy a car. The salesman doesn't try and sell him the car. He tries to learn what that person wants so he can sell him something he wants. Or position it to him in a way that he wants to buy it. What sort of car are you looking for? Oh, I'm looking for something for my family. Not too racy and safe. Okay, so you're looking for something for your family, not too racy and safe. Just by repeating that back to him, we're in rapport. It's what's called an agreement frame. Someone asks you in an interview, they say to you something like, what do you think are the qualities that are important to being successful at this job? And you look at him and you say, it's a great question. What do I think are the qualities that are important to being successful at this job? And while you're repeating that question back to him, you're figuring out through your profiling what he thinks are the qualities that are important. Is this person someone who's very personable, very gregarious? Is this person someone who is clearly very rigid and very numbers oriented? You can determine through profiling people what sort of answers they want to hear from you. Benefits, in your black book, you can lay out, what are your benefits? Why do they want to hire you? Not just hire someone, why do they want to hire you? Objections, why don't they want to hire you? When I walked into the two jobs on the buy side, there were two very, very clear objections. What have you been doing for 18 months? Most people think it's a death wish to be out of work for 18 months and then to walk into a job, right? It's disastrous. You got a big hole in your resume, right? It's obvious. The second objection, I don't have any buy side experience. I know that. I know that on the top of their mind, there are two reasons that they won't hire me. They're the objections. So in my black book, I write my best answers to them, which I'll share with you in a moment. But that's the thing, which is when you can run this sort of process, you're thinking so many steps ahead that every question you get in an interview, you had an opportunity to prepare for. And it might not be every, but it will probably be 80 or 90%. And then you can seem like it's natural. You're just rapping with this person. You seem very natural. But no, behind this, you've done this incredibly rigorous process. And then what's the next step? In every interview, in every meeting, you've got to try and drive to the next step. What do you really want? The next interview. So what are you saying throughout the interview that leads to that? This is more of a breakdown. These are more specific. Remember, if you do this right, you're creating this black book and you just keep drilling down even deeper, developing your best intelligence on what it takes to win. Q&A. These are obvious things, right? They're going to ask you a bunch of questions you want to have answers for. So write them out. More importantly, or as importantly, you want to be able to ask them the right questions to seem interested, to engage them, and also for profiling. If you can get that person talking within the first 2 minutes of the interview, you can learn so much about them that you can then utilize against them. It's like if, I don't know if any of you are fans of boxing. The first round of a boxing match, you know what happens? Each one of the components is feeling the other one out. They're looking at their style, they're figuring out how they can lead them, how they can pace them, how they can move them in different directions. If you get them talking at the start of the interview by asking some great questions, you can learn a lot about them, which you can then use to get them to like you. Benefits. Think about these simple categories. Why hire you? Why should they hire you? Specifically, what can you do for them? Remember, most people walk into an interview looking for a job. But imagine walking into an interview looking to do a great job for them. Then you're there as someone offering them something of value. There's a finance guru, a guy named Ramit Sethi, who has this great technique which I really like. And he calls it the briefcase technique. And the whole point of it is, when you step into that interview and you're talking about their business or you're talking about what they do, he then reaches into his briefcase and pulls out like a couple page slide deck and blows them away, because suddenly you're someone who's brought into that interview real value add ideas. You're not there begging for a job. You're there to offer them something of great value. And when you can turn the tables like that in an interview, it's no longer an interview. Remember what I said before, they are selling you. They want you. Prove it. The briefcase technique proves it. What value can I bring? Here's the ideas. But more generally, if they're asking you, what can you bring them? You have to be able to demonstrate it. I can't meet with a potential client and say, oh, I've never done this for anyone, but maybe I'll give it a shot. We'll see how we do. I have to prove to them that I can do what I do. I prove it to them by the fact I did it for myself, but I don't sell people on what I do. I give them a number of one of my clients and have them call my client. Prove it. Objections. This is a fantastic formula for blowing out objections. You don't have any experience on the buy side. The worst way to deal with an objection is to argue against it. So you got to agree, because people, then you're in agreement with them. You're right. You're right. It's a problem. I don't have any experience on the buy side. Then you mitigate it. What do you say? You say, yeah, it's a problem that I don't have any experience on the buy side, but I tell you, for the last 5 years, I've been reading these books. I've done this level of investing in my private account. This is what I think about what's happening in the markets. So you provide the arguments against it. The third step to blowing out an objection is you then sell through it. You find a reason why their objection can be turned to your favor. So what was the objection destroyer I used in my interviews? Yeah, it's true, and I tell you, the benefit is I don't come in here with any preconceived ideas on investing. You can train me to invest the way that you guys invest. So then suddenly to them, that's a benefit of what used to be the objection. The reason I go through these more specifically is because when you drill down in your black book and you get very, very clear on what you are doing in those meetings, you can develop such great intelligence that when you step into the meeting, you've done so much of that preparation that it becomes easy. If you've done thousands of hours of prep. A few years ago, I tried to help one of my friends to get back to work. It was a very difficult market, and I walked him through these sorts of ideas. All the stuff we've talked about. And for a few weeks, I did a call with him every week. And I said to him, even the best actor in the world would fail to land a job if he didn't know his lines. So you have to write this stuff down. And he argued against me. He said, no, you know what? I do better on the spot. When I sit there and they ask me a question, it just seems to flow. But if I sit down and try and write it, I just can't write it out. And I said, yeah, you're right. It's harder to write it down, isn't it? And he agreed, and he didn't. And so I stopped helping him, and he didn't really get a job. It took him a long time to get back to work. There's an old Zen story, and the Zen story sounds something like this. The student and the teacher go down to the river. The teacher grabs the student's head and pushes him underwater and holds him there. And to start with, the student's relaxed. He's just chilling out. He just, you know, it seems odd, but in Zen circles, there's not a lot of stuff that's really that odd. But then at some point, the teacher's not letting him up, and he starts scrambling, and he's trying to get back up. But the teacher is too strong, and he's scrambling, he can't get back up. And right when he's almost out of breath, the teacher lets him back up. And he comes back, and he's trying to get a breath. He's saying, why did you do that? Why did you do that? And the teacher says to him, what did you learn? He said, what do you mean? He said, what was the one thing that you were thinking while I was holding you underwater? He said, I wasn't thinking anything. All I wanted to do was breathe. The purpose of the story is when you want to get what you want as much as you want to breathe, then you'll do what it takes to get it. The steps that we've walked through today are about managing risk. They're about managing the greatest risk you face, which is that you take this education of yours and you don't get what you want. Years of college, lots of money, and it doesn't lead you to what you want. Or you spend the next 30 years of your life and then looking back, having lived a shadow of the life that you could live. And the formula, the preparation, taking control, taking a very deliberate approach to getting what you want in your life takes more effort. It takes deliberate focus. But when you want to get what you want, rather than be carried along by the tide that's washing most people in most parts of the world downriver, then you'll take the steps.